desejarem a tradução simultânea, por favor, colocar seus fones nesse momento, pois vamos para a última palestra do dia com o tema Advances and Opportunities for Research-Based Fire Protection. E convidamos o Dr. Lu Brizio, da FM Global.
I apologize I can't speak to you in your native language. I appreciate you wearing the headphones. For those of you who don't know FM Global, we're a bit of a unique company. First, we're a specialty company. We only do one thing, and that is that we protect the risk of commercial industrial properties around the world. We're owned by the clients that we insure. So we only serve one master, our customers, our owners, clients, all the same. But most importantly for this audience, the basis of FM Global's business is reducing risk through research-based engineering, and then we can ensure the risk that we can reduce. And since our clients and our owners, they receive the benefit of that risk reduction, and they receive the benefit of a favorable insurance policy as well. Who doesn't like saving money on insurance? So we've been doing this ever since the Molotov Tower, or the Arsenal de Marina, was started construction. In 1835, a group of mill owners, textile owners in New England realized they had a fire problem. That the production of textiles or the manufacturing of clothing at that time produced a lot of fires. That like combustibles, you had equipment, oil, all bad things. So the gentleman that owned this mill, Zachariah Allen, had an idea that he could reduce his risk. And he could actually put in measures that would reduce the risk of fire in his facility. So he went to his insurance company and said, I've done some great things to reduce the risk of my facility. How about better insurance? The insurance company said, no, no, no. The good risks pay for the bad, which is the way most insurance works. So Zachariah started what is now FM Global. At that time, it was a factory mutual fire insurance company. In 1835. This was his mill. This is it today. It's still there. It's now very nice apartments. They're also very good gifts. So it was built to last. He maintained his business, and he started a new model of how to do engineering and take research into engineering into reducing risk, really for societal benefit. And that's what I'm going to walk you through today, just a couple of examples. Some of the things that we've experienced, I look forward to talking to you afterwards over the next day or so about what you've learned as well, because these meetings are all about sharing knowledge. We have now 5,000 employees. 1,800 of those employees are engineers. We have 39 offices worldwide, including Sao Paulo. We make our engineering information publicly available, downloaded on our website. Because the way to reduce risk is to make sure that everybody knows it. And if they know about it and trust it, then risks are reduced. And we can write more good business as an insurance company. And we can help engineer risk and keep it. We do about 100,000 client facility risk assessments around the world every year. And unlike other insurance companies, we use those risk assessments as the basis for writing an insurance policy, or what you call an engineering-based underwriting. rather than look at a table and calculate statistically an average annual loss and set rates high enough to make profit, we look at the risk, reduce the risk, and ensure the risk is effective. So that poses some challenges, right? We need to know the risk market. We need to know how to reduce it. And then we need to be able to assess the reduction of risk to be able to be successful. Fires still pose the number one risk for commercial and industrial property. Fire has the biggest business impact of any peril on this planet. Majority of our losses in the past 5 years have been fire, and this includes, you saw this year, we've had hurricanes, we had an earthquake in Mexico City. This still, there's fires all over the world every day, and they still drive commercial, industrial, business, value, and production, which drives harm to local economies, loss of jobs, and reduction in public well-being. So we all have our tasks set out for us. Some of the protection challenges you well know. This is not my office. But it is increasingly what's happening around the world. More combustible loading in offices, hotels, apartments. Unfortunately, some of the combustible exteriors have caused some major problems around the world. Sadly, the Grenfell Tower is a great example. These are somewhat straightforward problems to solve from a research perspective. When we take a look at our history with offices, towers, apartments, established sprinkler criteria, and lack of plastics in construction, the lack of use of highly combustible wall panels on the outside, combustible wall panels have been tested at full scale, are really the two secret ingredients. Last week, we published this white paper. You can find it on our webpage. It talks about the cases that I've outlined in this table above and some of the comparative analysis of what's worked and what traffic has happened. So there are some solutions for these kinds of problems. The problem that we face, that we think about when we consider our fire service colleagues, is what's happening around the world in industry. And what's happening that produces fire protection challenges that we don't have solutions for. Most of these challenges are in storage. Storage is important to businesses because it's where their products are located. There's a lot of value there. When they lose their storage, they can't deliver their products to the customer. It's difficult for them to recover. But what we're seeing in storage now is taller, tighter, more plastic, higher fuel loads. And increasingly around the world, we're seeing the building built around the storage rather than the storage put in the building. So these are difficult protection challenges. What about passive protection? What about putting up walls? And great work on firewalls earlier today. The challenge with businesses putting up firewalls is it interrupts their operation. The reason they're building taller or tighter warehouses is to make it more efficient to move goods and services or goods and products from their storage to the transportation to where they can sell those products. Walls interfere with it. A wide open space, you may see in an art gallery, which looks nice, doesn't work for somebody that's trying to sell products. They want products close, so it's quick and easy to distribute. To solve these problems, we have some tools. Since 1964, we have a large parcel of land out in western Rhode Island. It's not too far from Massachusetts, where my main office is located. Over the years, it's developed into a 1,600-acre facility for fire research, fire testing for certification and education. The main tool for solving these kinds of problems is the large burn lab that we have at that facility. It seems outlined in the red box. And you can see that we have two 595 square meter movable ceilings. We go from 3 to 19 meters in elevation to account for different heights of ceilings. And we have up to 20 megawatt continuous calorimetry that we can measure the heat release from any fire scenario under either the movable ceilings or the calorimeter in the middle. This is our main tool. And this is how it looks when we apply that tool to solve a protection problem. At this 14 meter storage, you can see the fire has started down at the very bottom, right in what we call a blue space in between the storage and the center rack. And it's going up along the corrugated container board and the materials that are being stored. In about 20 seconds, this fire will reach the top of the storage. So this is typical of the warehouse fire scenario. It can be talked off in different ways. One of the most common ways is the forklift. Unfortunately, arson sometimes can cause. So you can see now that the fire has reached the top of the storage. It's now impinging on the ceiling. And it's also starting to grow laterally out towards the eye. Within a matter of seconds, it's yet to reach the 1 minute. This is a typical scenario for a warehouse fire that a fire officer would have to respond to, or that a building owner would have to be prepared to address. As the fire impinges on the ceiling, as it heats the fusible links and the sprinklers located at the ceiling, it will activate those sprinklers. And those sprinklers will disperse their water onto the flame zone and the top of the ceiling. You can see they've activated now about 1 minute. 20 seconds into the fire. You can see that they serve to knock some of the smoke layer down. This is a ventilated facility. We exhaust the smoke out and treat it so we don't release it to the environment. But it's protecting and knocking down the fire. The most challenging area to suppress the fire is in the open wall along the aisle in the open space. And the oxygen can grow up along the side. So this is an example of applying energy. As you can imagine, these tests are expensive. They cost between $10,000 and $100,000 US dollars. We perform on the order of 300 of these every year. So it's a significant amount of money. We're looking at all different kinds of storage. Boats, whiskey barrels, standard materials. So there's still a challenge even being able to do experiments for all of those. So how do we achieve better protection other than just testing and learning and testing and learning? Well, we need to have better tools that we can use in addition to the research campus facilities. So in 2008, we started an initiative, a long-term research program, to develop an open source CFD, computational fluid dynamics based fire model that will help us get better insight into the tests that we do, potentially solve some of our simple problems, but most importantly, give us the ability to be smarter and fewer tests. And we collaborate with universities around the world, and I hope that some of those collaborations will result from our time here in Brazil today. We have annual meetings where we gather knowledge, we implement that into this open source toolkit, and we improve the capabilities to be able to predict certain fire scenarios. It is a physics-based approach. We do solve the mass, momentum, chemistry, and soot equations on a computational grid. We have different grids, meshes that are used in the gas space, in the solid space, and the liquid space, to be able to calculate this as close to first principles as possible. So it's not something you run on a laptop. We've determined that this level of rigor is necessary to do a reasonable job in predicting fire growth and suppression of climate space. And I'll walk you through how this was done very quickly. Each year, we set out key major milestones for the development team in terms of fire scenarios that they need to be able to calculate and validate their calculations.
We started with a simple gas-based void plume. We went to a reactive plume that had radiation transfer. We then looked at a wall fire to ensure that we could calculate the effective heat transfer law. The parallel panel is a test that we use to certify building materials, wall panels. It's a simple geometry. It's very well enclosed. It has a burner at the bottom. We looked at how we can use compatibility measurements at small scale to be able to apply those to the panel, and then ultimately to that storage. So that's the fire growth piece, but what we're really interested in is the suppression piece, coupled with fire growth. So in this case, we took sprinklers at different pressures, we measured the mass flux of water, the momentum, the droplet size, the velocity of the water coming from those sprinklers over a hemisphere that was far enough away from the sprinkler to where the droplets had already formed and they're not still breaking up. We calculate the trajectory of those droplets through the plume, when they contact the surface, how they flow over that surface and down the surface to the shine. Each of these models were developed by going into the laboratory, doing experiments to learn what's important, and then performing calculations and comparing those calculations with a different set of experiments. So we use an iterative, discover, develop, validate approach for each of the pieces of the model. And along the way, we had great collaboration with our university and lab partners. And then ultimately, to be able to predict the back storage scenario suppression for a simple material, corrugated particle boxes, including the activation of sprinklers, the trajectory of droplets, and the effect of that water on the storage. So what we've learned from this is, I think, some things that make sense to fire protection engineers. What we know is that the important thing is getting water to the base of the flame, to be able to get the water on the burning material, to control the pyrolysis reactions of that burning material. That's a little difficult to hear. Okay. Usually that's not a problem. Maybe it's the vent. I wish somebody had said something earlier. Is this better?
Yeah.
It seems loud to me, but I'm right here.
Okay.
Okay. I apologize if you couldn't hear me in the back. We'll do a repeat performance over cocktails tonight. So the key to effective sprinkler protection then is getting the water to the base of the flame. And the best we could do with sprinklers at the ceiling only for the challenging things that we're trying to protect is storage is 12 to 14 meters high. So at that level, you could use large orifice sprinklers and get enough water to the bottom to protect that storage. But what about protecting unlimited storage? This warehouse is now taller, tighter. So over the past few years, we implemented a stage-wise approach, doing again experiments and calculations to determine how we could put levels of in-rack sprinklers in as few as possible, because those in-rack sprinklers raise the cost, and then be able to control the fire within the zone of the storage. So we used a method of looking where the water goes, calculating how that water will go with a computational model, then moving sprinklers around at different sizes and pressures, doing small scale experiments to see if we could control the fire within the zone, and ultimately determining a critical water flux for a certain zone of storage. So if there's a certain density of water that gets to the base of the storage at a certain time, we can control that fire. If you don't, and the fire wins, and it will go out of control. Then we verify this with large-scale experiments. You can see here the order of 16-liter storage in our lab with three different levels of in-rack sprinklers to be able to control fires within those zones. So what this resulted in was the ability to protect all kinds of materials at unlimited height, depending upon the material. Those in-rack sprinklers were located either 10 meters or 13 meters apart. A significant benefit is by controlling the fire within a zone, the fire never goes above a level of in-racks.
So a fire that starts anywhere is controlled within either Interact or ceiling protection. Therefore, you don't need to supply water to both the Interact sprinklers and the ceiling sprinklers. In fact, if you don't have storage above the top level of Interact, you don't have to have ceiling sprinklers. So this significantly reduced the water demand and reduced the cost relative to existing standards for high storage protection, order of 35%. This is in our data sheet 8.9. You can download this data sheet from our webpage. It is available in Spanish and Portuguese. So this is publicly available information that can be used by anyone that's interested. And we hope it's applied. Remember, our goal is to reduce risk so that we and our mutual clients can benefit. We have a simple one-pager if you want to send this along to your friends. We have a newsroom on the webpage. You can go to that newsroom and download the summary. We have some other initial hazards. I want to just touch on this one. I know it's not maybe as big of an issue as others, but in some areas of the world, there's large storage facilities with rolls of paper. So every piece of paper that we touch came from a roll of paper at some point in its life. And that those rolls of paper are stacked on top of each other with a robotic control system. So there are no racks. So we have the same challenge of how we control a fire in these kinds of scenarios without the benefit of being able to install in rack sprinklers. It's a similar approach. One of the challenges for these kinds of materials is when a level of the outside of the paper burns, it falls away and reveals more paper. So it's a continuous fuel source. There's no buildup of char layer like you would see in other materials. So the fire grows not only very quickly, but it continues to intensify as this progression occurs. So we follow a stepwise progression of doing some small-scale experiments to look at that shedding, what we call exfoliation of paper. Same time, look at sprinkler injection, compare free burn, that was just burning the material under a calorimeter to measure its heat release rate, look at small experiments of sprinkler water on top of that material, and then move to fire growth and sprinkler activation coupled with being able to calculate the spray dynamics of plume, ultimately resulting in a solution for very high storage of roll paper. We have new solutions for heavyweight paper. Unfortunately, tissue paper is much harder because it absorbs all the water. All the water that falls on the top of tissue paper is immediately absorbed. That's what tissue paper does. So that's a challenge we're still working on for our vendor. We have been able to come up with a solution for them. Now let's move to the future. The future is all about robotic storage in plastic containers, tightly packed. And there's different kinds of these automated storage and retrieval systems that are already in practice and are continuing to be developed. The most common is on the left. It's called a mini load system, where plastic boxes are used to hold the material, and robots pick the boxes up, select product from them, and move them for shipment. There's other robotic racks, where actually the racks move around, and then top loading systems, where products are dropped down from the top. All of these have similar challenge in terms of a lot of plastic and very, very tight spaces. Right now, when we compare what we know about protecting these materials to standard storage, we can protect them with sprinkler protection only at about the 8-meter level. Much taller than that, and we cannot get sufficient water down to deal with the burning plastic cooling on the bottom of the storage. The further challenge is there's many different kinds of boxes. The ones that have vents are better because the water flows through them. The ones that are solid are more challenging because they capture all the water at the top and don't allow water to go to the base of the fire. Again, we follow the same approach. We use the tools that we have and we develop with our colleagues to look at an experience of where the water will, how the water will be transported, how fast it will be transported, the calculations for different locations of sprinklers, get into the laboratory, do fire tests for different pressures and locations of sprinklers to be able to develop some new solutions. We followed the same modular scheme that we did for in-rack protection of standard warehouse storage, just trying to control the fire within a certain zone or in-rack storage system, and ultimately resulted in a protection solution that involves levels of sprinklers either at 3 meters or 4.5 meters, depending upon whether the boxes are open or closed, using either K160 to K360 sprinklers. It requires sprinklers to be all the way out of the face to control the fire growing up along the side. The plastic boxes, that's a significant challenge. But they can be tucked behind the supports so they don't get hit by the robot. Sprinkler gets hit by the robot, causes a problem of water leaks. So again, this has been in our data sheets. The data sheet we have for this is data sheet 834. We did have protection for some of these scenarios before. The protection that we had a lot more levels of sprinkler protection and required 776 liters of water to protect plastic storage or storage in plastic boxes. The new approach, because we have larger sprinklers, fewer levels, better engineering, requires on the order of a third of that water. So less water means smaller pump, less pipe, lower cost. And all of us as fire protection engineers know that the challenge to reducing risk, oftentimes, pretty much all the time, is the cost. We can usually figure out some way to reduce the risk, but how can we do it at a cost that can be used and applied in practice? There's another advantage to saving water, and that is that we have water problems around the world. This is water scarcity, is according to the United Nations UNDP. And included in the areas where we're approaching physical water scarcity is where we are located right now in Recife. So this is not just a problem in India or Africa. It's also a problem in Texas, where I went to college, and here in Brazil. So what about using other solutions to use less water, like water mist, just fine droplets moving? Or hypoxic solutions, ones that flood the space with nitrogen and drive all the oxygen out so a fire can't grow. Let's take a look at those as solutions. For sprinklers, it's getting water to the bottom. For water mist, it's getting those small droplets in the actual flame zone. And we've developed extinction models for that physics as well. When you look at droplet going through a flame interface, fuel air interface, the size of the droplet, its residence time determines whether or not it will quench that flame and that flame will stay quenched, or whether it will not quench the flame and the flame will relight. So these are very small millimeter scale kinds of physics that can be integrated into the grid cells in the larger computational fluid dynamics model called subgrid scale modeling. So if we look at using those tools and we validate those with experiments, we find that water mist works very well, and this is fairly well known, in enclosed spaces where you can inject a small amount of water in along with the air, and it mixes with the air and burns in the flame zone. But what about storage? What about open spaces? We did a series of experiments and found that you need about the same amount of water as a sprinkler to protect storage. Water mist. And unfortunately, water mist systems require higher pressure, the reliability is good, but not quite as good as sprinkler systems. So not potentially a good example of a good solution for big open spaces or warehouse storage. Very good solution for storing ignitable liquids in a cutoff or a separate room that's away from this. Now let's look at getting the oxygen out. Hypoxic systems. In one of our smaller labs, we set up a mock-up of a warehouse that we could inject nitrogen into that could have storage and control the amount of oxygen and did a set of controlled experiments using different oxygen levels to look at the fire growth both during or after ignition and then after the ignition source was no longer present. And you see that in this case, for 11.4% of oxygen, you can still sustain a growing fire in very simple combustible materials. Depending upon where in the world you're located, there are different levels of oxygen concentration that humans are allowed to work in. And 11.4% is below all of it. So this is a challenging solution for occupied spaces. It does work fairly well, and we did sufficient experiments to be able to determine with 95% confidence for commonly stored materials what the threshold for these hypoxic systems would be. And for this case, it turns out to be around 11.5%. So very good solution for small spaces that are not occupied. Drive the oxygen out. Control ignition sources likely will not get a growing fire, but for large open spaces, again, a challenge. Which leads us back to sprinklers. So if that's what we're dealing with, can we make them better? Can we make them smarter? I have two examples of ways that we're working with our partners to make sprinklers better and smarter. The first is looking at the way sprinklers distribute water. Water comes out of the hole, it's a deflector, it's upright, pendant, and it breaks into droplets. The challenge we've discussed is to get those droplets to the seat of the flame. So what we've developed is there's techniques that we have used from other disciplines to do what's called volume or fluid, which models the sheets of fluid and how they break up into droplets on the computer. Using, again, same kind of physics-based principles of mass, momentum, and energy, and also the instabilities in those liquids. What we're hoping to do here is to be able to optimize the way that water comes out of a common sprinkler for different kinds of storage challenges, including the momentum and the size of the drops, that will fine-tune how we can protect different materials. But again, the goal of reducing cost, reducing water, to get going. We still think we can make sprinklers smarter. So a few years ago, we undertook a project to co-locate a series of sensors with sprinklers. So each sprinkler becomes a sensor measurement device for temperature and rate of heat release. And then we can take those data and, using an Internet of Things approach, determine, is there a fire? Where exactly is it? How big is that fire? And how many sprinklers and which sprinklers do we need to activate to be able to quickly extinguish that fire? So then the sprinkler becomes valve controlled and it becomes integrated with a set of sensors and an algorithm that drives those sensors to drive the sprinkler to make smart decisions. So we've tested this in a number of scenarios. For simple storage cases, we've experienced that we can reduce water requirements by 50%. And since we're only activating the sprinklers where they're needed, we can reduce the water damage. And since we're activating them sooner or earlier, we can also reduce the smoke damage. Smoke doesn't have time to go out and cascade and fall down at a large distance away from the fire source. capture those. We also have this work on our webpage downloaded. Unfortunately, it's only in English, but we can certainly work with it. Okay, so in terms of conclusions, reducing damage is the key. We know that there are challenges to building construction that will withstand a fire, but if we can reduce the damage, we can make that economic impact of fire scenarios much smaller. And that helps everyone. New validated tools provide better solutions. Proven, lower cost. We believe the proven is still important. We will never calculate everything on it. We need to see the physical reality to be able to make sure that we're not missing something. And I encourage all of us to take that same approach. We need that validation in the laboratory, in the field, to make sure that we don't miss something. I'd also encourage you to check the facts and the data on new solutions for fire protection that may be sold in the marketplace. Not everything that's new is better. Some things are, but still I encourage you to test them in the laboratory or work with your partners to test them in the laboratory, as we work with our clients and they may need to do as well. Finally, I believe the future of fire protection will be digital. I believe digital systems will be integrated with the common fire protection system. It will make those systems initially a little less reliable. We have done some studies on that. But in time, the reliability will be just as good, if not better, than our current systems today. We all have a digital system in our back pocket, coat pocket. We drive one every time we turn the key to go somewhere. And I believe it's just a matter of time before digital systems will be the future of fire protection. So with that, I think we can achieve what the Molotov Tower and what Zachariah Allen's mill 180 years ago did, which is we can design better buildings and maintain them to last by reducing the damage and harm of fire in those structures. This was not my work. This was the work of many people that I'm fortunate enough to work with. So I am not the master chef. I am the person that printed the menu. So you see on this list all of the people that work in fire research at FM Global. What I haven't listed is our partners in academia, people that work in different branches of fire research, as well as our equipment and systems reliability, our international codes and standards organization, Marcelo Lima, who many of you know, is right here and works to be able to communicate and partner with people throughout South America to advance loss protection solutions. So I want to make sure that as you leave today, you acknowledge the work of a huge team of people that have accomplished whatever we were able to accomplish, and know that we still have a long way to go, but I would appreciate your questions. And again, I appreciate the opportunity to address you today. It's a huge honor to be here in Brazil.
Senhoras e senhores, neste momento abriremos para perguntas antes do encerramento. Nosso palestrante também colocará um fone. Tradução simultânea, inglês, português, português, inglês. Alguém gostaria de fazer uma pergunta?
Não. Luiz, parabéns pela apresentação. Eu senti falta de falar de outras tecnologias, que eu entendo que o Splinter é bom, mas não é a melhor tecnologia que existe. Por exemplo, no caso do papel que foi mostrado, vai apagar o incêndio, mas vai danificar todos os equipamentos.
Tem que colocar.
Ok, não pronto. Ok. Eu acredito que faltou a FM Global comentar de outras tecnologias que foram desenvolvidas e é melhor que a água em missões críticas. Por exemplo, um data center, quando você não vai verificar os materiais, que no caso ele mostrou os papéis, então eu vou apagar o incêndio, mas eu vou verificar tudo que eu tenho ali com a água. Então, por exemplo, um agente químico não faria isso. Então, por exemplo, Novec 1230 seria uma opção. Então, eu acho que falta mostrar outras tecnologias que tem disponível e também certificada pela FM Global num congresso como esse.
Do it this way. This is excellent. This could happen before, like for a TV show. If I understand your question correctly, the challenge is all the different kinds of things out there, storage, chemical plants, and all those hazards, and how do we deal with those, and how do we develop new solutions to the market? So you're correct. There's a lot of fat fire challenges that I did not talk about today because of the interest of time. And so what we will do typically is we will look and see where the big problems are, and specifically the problems that we see coming down the line. So new ways of storage, new chemicals. For example, for manufacturing of flat screen TVs, there's a chemical called silane that is used in that process. It's highly reactive. So we will look at that hazard and work with our clients to develop a solution. If we develop something new, let's say we come up with a new solution, we will patent it, but we will non-exclusively, royalty-free, license it anywhere in the world. Okay? So we don't make anything. What we want are other companies to make things that are solutions for our clients. And in fact, we have a business called FM Approvals that certifies products, performance, and so the manufacturing of products and the certification of those products is a contract that we still need to be available. Does that answer your question?
Temos mais perguntas?
Além de... além de desafios técnicos, e outros desafios vocês têm na implementação dos seus projetos? Além dos desafios técnicos, tecnologia ser desenvolvida para ser aplicada para a minha dica. Que outros desafios vocês têm?
The challenges, the technology that we see today, what are the big challenges that in terms of having those systems used and in moving forward? It's a great question. The first challenge from a very practical standpoint is that fire protection systems are put in by what we call in the United States plumbers. And they're put in by people that know water, and they know pumps, and they know pipes. They don't know computers. They don't know digital systems. Okay? So there needs to be a marriage of those skills. And companies that produce these systems need to come together with the skills, the digital skills, as well as the actual equipment skills that are necessary to bring this into the marketplace in a reliable and affordable fashion. That is the biggest hurdle for these things being available next month or next year. It's a cultural and skill blending. A good example of this, in the United States, we have garage doors. Okay? And now I can get my garage, find out if my garage door is open on my phone. Okay? There's a sensor, and it goes to the internet, and it comes down to my phone here in Brazil and tells me my garage door is open. The company that makes those garage doors had to go through a major cultural change to bring in the skills of people that could install computer systems on the garage door. There were labor laws that prevented them from working together. So there's a very practical set of constraints. However, the market has shown time and time again that it will overcome those hurdles. The other big challenge is just the dynamic nature of the storage and the use of different buildings. And I'm sure the fire service knows this very well. A building is built for one thing, it's used for something else. And those changes can occur overnight. Technology will be tailored towards the one thing. If the thing changes, the technology needs to know. So I think those are the good challenges. Thank you for your question. Can I answer your question?
Temos mais alguma pergunta? Mais alguém? Última chamada. Muito bem, então, vamos encerrando por aqui essa tarde de palestras e sessões. Teremos um momento aqui, o nosso coordenador quer entregar um presente aqui para o último palestrante, para o Dr. Lu. Por gentileza, o coordenador José Jefferson pode vir aqui à frente. Agradecemos a presença e a palestra do Dr. Lu Britzio. E o cerimonial desse evento agradece também a presença de todos os coordenadores, palestrantes e participantes das sessões temáticas. Convidamos a todos para a continuidade do evento amanhã e quarta-feira. E fiquem agora com o nosso cocktail de abertura, que é uma cortesia da FM Global. Boa noite a todos e até amanhã.